Rejoice in the Lord. Give him praise. Give him glory. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that you have granted us to speak your name in the congregation of the righteous. You are the one that draws us to yourself. Our journey in you is not a function of our intention, but by your sovereignty, you reached out to us and you brought us in, and you are leading us through in a journey in yourself. We ask that you grant us understanding and insight in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We'll spend some time doing some Bible study this morning. You may be seated. Pull your Bibles out. Let's study the Bible. Hallelujah. I was praying towards the inception of the year and trying to find my bearing. And for many days in the prayer and fasting season, I was trying to actually articulate the emphasis of God for my life in the new season, and the things that God will have me share whenever I'm found and given the opportunity to minister in the congregation of the righteous. And God began to give me insight, and he began to bring me to an understanding of what I titled the many dimensions of the experience of God. Turn your Bible with me to 1 John. I'll commence my reading from verse 1. 1 John. I'll commence my reading from verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that you may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. If you are still there, say amen. Amen. Now, this man was trying to bring us into an understanding of eternal reality. If you notice the way the book of 1 John began, you'll be able to trace it to the book of St. John, chapter 1. Because he began 1 John in the same manner that he began the book of John, chapter 1. For instance, in the book of John, chapter 1, it reads, in the beginning was the Word. It was as if John was trying to access the origin of all things so that he will bring us into perfect light of what God expects at every point and every junction in time. John began in the book of John, chapter 1, to give us insight into the revelation of an eternal personality. If we look upon that scripture from the standpoint of the original language, the original Greek language from whence it was translated, the manuscript was translated to English, it reads, in the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and the Logos was God. Hallelujah. In the Greek language, the Logos, the word Logos sustains two meanings. First of all, it means the utterance. In the beginning, there was a personality that gave utterance and expression to God. You must understand that if God wants to display himself, if God wants to unravel himself, he cannot explain who he is, he cannot manifest who he is by any other means other than himself. Did that make sense? All right. I didn't make sense. All right. You see, God can never be defined except the utterance speaks about him. The revelations of God can only be conveyed by the personality called the utterance. And that's why we said yesterday that a revelation is not a thing, it's not an idea, it's not a concept, it's not a fact that you stumble into mentally. Are you still with me now? Now, you see, we said revelation was not just stumbling into a statement of fact, but actually coming into the environment of a personality. That personality is the personality that can reveal God, that can speak about God, that can communicate God, that can bring you into the experience of God. Are you still with me now? So every time God is communicated, every time God is revealed, every time God is put on display, it will be by the agency of this personality that John stumbled upon in the realm of the spirit, and he called him the utterance, the one that bears the faculty sufficient enough and sustains enough stature to give explanation, to give insight about God. And so when Jesus shows up around the corridors of your life, what happens is that an unveiling takes place and the revelations of God begin to become available and accessible to you, because it is him that is the utterance that communicates and brings the mysteries of God to the plane where you can access it, to the plane where you can understand it. Are you with me now? So that's the first definition of the word logos, is what? The utterance. The utterance. The utterance. In the beginning was the utterance. Now you see, there were several times in scripture where Jesus manifested his divinity. One of such times was when he gave the apostles an instruction that they had to cross from one side of the riverbank to the other side. And then the entire creation began to revolt against that mission. In fact, the wind came boisterous, so much so that fishermen that were skillful in the art of fishing became jittery about the possibility of their survival. And suddenly, Jesus, that was sleeping at the foot of the boat, was quickened. And when he was quickened, he spoke to the wind. And instantly, there was a great calm. So much so that people began to wonder, who is this man that even the wind and the waves obey him? Is the utterance. He spoke the same word he spoke when creation was fashioned. And creation has to identify that utterance, that frequency. And creation had to submit to him, because he is what? The utterance. Every time God is revealed, every time God is put on display, every time God is manifested, every time the perspective of God is revealed to you, to me, to anybody, to a congregation, it means the utterance is speaking. And whenever your life begins to lack the ministry of the utterance, what is happening to you is that you are beginning to walk in darkness, where there is no vision, where the utterance doesn't put God on display in the lives of men. Their lives follows a pattern of cycles and circles and doesn't get to strike any chord in eternity. I pray that God will open your ears. I pray that God will open your eyes so that you will not walk the walk of men, but your feet will be guided by the utterance. Secondly, the word logos translates to the knowledge. The knowledge. Now, you see, there's no way we can talk about God, because my assignment this year actually is to bring God and put God on display for you, so that everybody will have access, will understand God and know how to connect with him. If God didn't want us to know him, he wouldn't have sent the Holy Spirit. Because the Bible says that we have received a spirit which is not of this world, but a spirit which is of God, that we may know the things that are freely given to us of God. Except by the agency of the Holy Spirit, we are cut off from the economy of God and that which he has put in place by his administrative arrangement in order to fulfill his eternal purpose. It's the Spirit of God that unravels our understanding, opens our understanding, so that we can access those dimensions and function in the realm that God wants us to be. The knowledge. Every time you operate with God, you walk with God, you will notice that God operates on a frequency of knowledge that is far beyond the scope of your mind. If you are to follow the testimony of Hannah, after that she had gone through barrenness for a season, and by contact with God, and by encountering God, her womb was open again, and she gave birth to a son, and she began to pray a prayer, and the prayer also now became an exhortation. And she said that our God, can we read that scripture in the book of, I guess it's 2 Samuel? 1 Samuel? Let's read that scripture quickly. But don't forget where we are starting from. We are starting from the book of 1 John chapter 1. And throughout this year on this platform, that's the scripture we'll be dealing with. Throughout the 12 months of this year, we'll not deviate. We'll just remain on that scripture. Remain on that scripture. Because God encountered me with this scripture. And I think it's time to broadcast it. Now, turn with me to 1 Samuel quickly. Let's see the utterances of Hannah. First Samuel chapter 2, if you are with me, say amen. And Anna prayed and said, my heart rejoiceth in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth is enlarged over my enemies because I rejoice in thy salvation. There is none holy as the Lord. She has moved from worshiping God, from exalting God, and she has moved into an exhortation. An exhortation is a spirit-inspired utterance that has a capacity to build the confidence of God in the hearts of men. So she had moved from extolling God, moved from giving glory to God, and now she came under a different influence, and now she's given an exhortation. An exhortation is predicated upon an intrinsic, intimate revelation of God that crystallizes on the very privacy and in the core of our being. And is precipitated there by the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost gives us faith and utterance to communicate it. Such a potent word, such potent utterances have power from God to establish confidence in God in the hearts of men. So she had moved from giving thanks. She had moved from giving praise. And at this point, she was speaking about God. He said, there is none holy as what? I can't hear you. For there is none besides thee. Neither is there any rock like our God. Talk no more exceeding proudly. Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. It took a revelation for her to make that utterance. She said, don't talk too much just because you are strong. Tell your neighbor, don't talk too much. I saw you on Monday, you were boasting. I saw you in the bank. After looking at your account balance, you came out of the bank with a limp. This woman is saying, don't boast, don't boast. Because our God operates on a superlative dimension of knowledge. And it's on the strength of this knowledge that he can actually put into context the motivation that engendered the actions of men. Are you with me now? So we cannot talk about God without talking about a modicum of knowledge. In fact, he is knowledge himself. And if you are encountering God, God will be opening websites, vistas, and causing you to gain entrance into spiritual knowledge. Spiritual knowledge gives you understanding and advantage in spiritual activities so that you know the consequences that should result after you carry out a spiritual activity. And your faith is steadfast because you understand the principles that regulate that sphere of influence that you have knowledge about. You understand what I'm talking about? You cannot advance in the spirit realm, advance in the kingdom of God outside of the knowledge of God that you have. And it happens to be that knowledge in the spirit realm is not something you study, it's something that comes by revelation. It precipitates in the very core of your being. It leaps out of your system, and you know it's not a precursor of your mind. Our God is a God of knowledge. And so when John was taking us to the book of John chapter 1, and he said, in the beginning was the Word. He was talking about a compendium of knowledge that gives utterance to his purposes. a personality that was a compendium of knowledge that does what? Gives utterance. It doesn't conceal his purposes. It declares his purposes. And by the time we go to the book of Hebrews chapter 1, we see more clearly the personality of the Word had come on display here. The incarnation had taken place. God, the personality of the Word, had been made flesh. And when the personality of the Word was made flesh, all he did on earth was to define God. Because he was the only one empowered to what? To communicate God, to express God. So in the book of Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, the Bible says, God, in diverse manners and in diverse ways, speak unto the fathers by the prophets, but he has in this last day spoken unto us by his Son. Alright? So when Jesus was made manifest, what he did was that he gave expression to God. He revealed how God will operate in natural human circumstances if he were man. He's still fulfilling his assignment as the utterance. And every time he shows up, he gives expression and perspective to God's context. Once upon a time, they came to him and they said, who sinned that this man was born blind? I hope you know, prior to that time, there was no possibility of making such an inquiry. Because the only possibility of inquiring from God was either that you met a priest that was gifted in the ways of the Urim and the Thurim, or it's either that you met a prophet that could access the mind of God and download the template of heaven, or it's either that you study the law and find the perspective of God concerning the issue that is bothering you. But you come to realize that it's not every issue that is captured in the law, so you will need a prophet to give you insight. You will need the Urim and the Thurim sometimes to actually find out if God was at peace with the action that he wanted to embark upon. But here was a day where if people wanted to understand the underlying purposes of God, the underlying intent of God, for even allowing a man to be born blind, they had access to a personality that could give them the such an insight. It was because the Word of God was on display for all humanity to see how God would have operated if he were man. That's still the utterance coming into stronger form of expression, so that no man will have the excuse that he doesn't know how God would have operated. He was beaten many times. He was accused wrongly many times. They tried to kill him many times. Hallelujah. But he opened not his mouth. So we saw God's character on display when Jesus was manifested upon the face of the earth. His assignment is to give voice and expression to God. You see it now? Okay. So, by the time we move to the book of 1 John, because in the book of John, he's trying to make us understand that there's no possibility of knowing God outside of the personality that he identified as the Word. Please help me tell your neighbor. You can't know God outside of the Christ. Because it's a Christ that bears his testimony. It's a Christ that will reveal him. It's a Christ that speaks for him. It's a Christ that makes him manifest. That's his ministry. That's what he does in his most natural state of existence. If he passes by and maybe you see him wave his hand, an expression of God is actually tied to that wave. Do you understand what I'm talking about? If you can enter into his thoughts, an expression of God will be revealed to his thoughts. The Bible said that Jesus was writing on the ground when they asked him. This woman was caught in the very act of adultery, and according to the law of Moses, she should be stoned to death. What say ye? What did he do? Oh my God. he began to write on the ground. And somehow, scriptures did not reveal to us what he wrote. You were not there that day. If you were there that day, that writing that he was writing was also expressing God. There's nothing he does that doesn't express God. His thoughts were the thoughts of God. His feelings were the feelings of the Word of God. His utterances revealed the person of God. His, oh my God,
it was just an utterance that gave expression to God. Are you with me now? Now, so in the book of 1 John, he spoke about this personality called the Word. But by the time we move to the book of 1 John chapter 1, he now begins to talk about not just this personality, because he expects that you should have known the personality. Because in his previous book, when he was introducing his previous book, he gave us insight into that personality. In fact, the purpose, the sole purpose for which the book of John was written, was to give us insight into that personality called the Word that has been made flesh. And if we do the panoramic view of the book of John, you come to realize 18 things in the book of John that actually reveal the unique display of divinity that was revealed through the ministry of Jesus. Unique display of divinity. Hallelujah. But that's not our emphasis now. By the time we go to the book of 1 John, what do you see? He begins to speak on another level. And he is speaking in the book of 1 John. What he communicates is actually the experience of God. Hallelujah. Now, in John is what? The knowledge of God. Because what we see in John 1 is definition. What we see in John 1 is that he's bringing an awareness of a spiritual personality. Alright? But in 1 John 1, we see him using the same word in the beginning. And then you just know that it's the same guy that wrote 1 John that wrote John. But there's another perspective he's trying to bring to our notice, because he begins to speak about the experience of that personality that he introduced to us previously. The experience of God. Now, you see, the truth of the matter is this. The knowledge of God is actually intertwined with the experiences of him that you have. You know, those days I felt that if you study the Bible very, very much, which I encourage everybody to study, that you just come out a guru, somebody that knows God so much. And I went on an assignment. I studied from Genesis to Revelation, from Revelation to Genesis, and I did it for many years. I could quote whole chapters. I could quote whole verses. I could preach and pluck out a chapter from the Bible and quote it and give expression to it, and you'll be ventilated. But you see, I came to realize several years later that the knowledge of God was beyond my ability to cram and quote. It was tied to my experience of the eternal personality that John was trying to introduce. And in the book of 1 John, we see John speaking about the dimensions of experience. The dimensions of experience that are in God. Amen? So my assignment throughout this year is to bring us into the understanding, obviously within the limits of my own understanding. Because there's nothing exhaustive that I can say about what we want to confront now. It's nothing exhaustive. Are you with me? We are looking at the dimensions of the experience of God. Come with me to 1 John. Let's look upon it again. 1 John, please turn. So as the prophet comes from his own dimension, I will leave him there. Let him do what he knows how to do. This is my own way. All right. You know, he was just swinging from one point in the spirit, swinging to another point, bringing illumination. He flows in revelation and truth. Hallelujah. Swinging, just swinging like that. In fact, if you are not tuned, if you didn't pray before you came for the meeting, most of what took place yesterday, you were not in it. But you see, spiritual things are like parables sometimes. It can enter into your spirit, maybe take 5 years to unlock. So spiritual things can never be wasted. If Jacob stumbled on Bethel, a place where his grandfather opened a website, and many, many generations later, he entered into the things that were already open by somebody's sacrifice and obedience, I believe that even though understanding didn't come to you fully, it's available to you.
In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah.
That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes. Somebody say heard. Seen. And handled. Looked upon. He's trying to bring us into the dimensions of the experience of God. Because previously he had given us the knowledge of God. And now he wants to give us the experience of God. Now, you see, in Nigeria, we talk a lot about God. There's a particular church like that. If you meet any of their members, they quote scriptures a lot and all of that. Amen. Okay, it's that one that you're thinking. That one. They quote so much scriptures that choke you with scriptures and make you. And then when you stay for a while and try their lives, you will see that it is devoid of what they speak about. Now, see, the encountering God and having the knowledge of God is not a function of how many scriptures you can quote. I told you that I did so much scriptural juggernaut. I could quote scripture. I could do all of that. Amen. But when we went to the field of missions, see, you need to go on mission field sometimes. The field of missions, some demons in Idoma land accosted us. I was preaching opposite the house of a necromancer, and the guy came into my room in the night. Maybe he wanted us to talk or something. He showed up. That was when I knew I didn't know God. So I now spoke to God, even though I said, if you deliver me today, I will. Well, he delivered me anyway. But it was clear to me that night that I did not know God. So I left that place in search of him. May it be clear to you if you know your God or not these few days, so that you can embark on a desperate search for him. The testimony has not ended. Many years later, when I taught some things in the spirit, I went there again. The man packed. And it's not as if I accumulated more scriptures, but I came into experience. And so John is trying to bring us a step deeper, and he's saying, we heard it. All right? And then he said, we looked upon it. That means that which we heard. What God did is that he substantiated it. Now, if we read, are you still with me? Now, there's a lot to cover, so that's why we can't stay on any point and explain in detail. Now, the Lord can come to you and he say, thou, mighty man of valor. I hope you know that utterance was actually backed up with divine potency. Apart from the hearing of the ear, it casts a substance on your heart. I don't know. All right. Have you ever prayed before and in your time of prayer, you heard God speak to you? All right, but beyond what he said to you, something hung on your heart. Now, you see, the voice of God wants to translate his dealings with you into experience, something that touches your heart. Because if anything in God does not affect your heart, it cannot affect your life. And so it's possible for you to attend a conference and then you come back with so many notes in your notepad and your heart is not heavy from the weight of the things that have come into you from the spirit realm. That exercise of taking notes was futile. Except you take your notes back and begin to pray on the things that you were instructed in, and then the Lord comes and kindles substance to that which you receive. Then it becomes your own. You see, beyond the hearing of the ear, that's quite natural. All right, as I'm saying now, God so loved the world, is quite natural. But I can be preaching that and saying that, and then somebody begins to break down under conviction because the thing has gone beyond what everybody heard. A substance of his reality has been fashioned and formed on the person's heart, and that one has dimensions. The person can feel it. It's just like your heartbeat. Do you understand what I'm talking about? If your heart is beating you, if you put your hand there or put your ear there, you'll be able to hear the vibration that is going on. That thing he said is actually spirit and life. and it has the ability to form itself on your heart. And so it goes beyond just your hearing. It comes to become something that has formed itself on your heart. And you see, as you move from one level to another level, it's more difficult for you to be confused. Now, the guy that just heard can be confused eventually, because he can go somewhere and hear something else, and then he can now begin to become confused about what he heard the first time. So he doesn't know where to stand. All right? But if you go from hearing to seeing, when that which you heard now becomes a substance upon your heart. You know, the Bible says faith is the substance. But I will want to render it this way. Faith is the substantiation. Faith is the what? Substantiation of things hoped for. It's as if hope is two-dimensional. It doesn't have the third dimension that will make it a substance. So what faith does is that it gives substance to the things that you have desired, to the things that you hope for. And at that point where it becomes substance, it means it is now real in the realm of the spirit. And a man that has substance in his spirit is more difficult to deceive, because he's moving more into the experience of the things that have been opened. Now, some of the things that kept, now, you heard the prophet yesterday. There were many times in his walk with God where he did not find reference points.